About And the scriptures speak about clothing. You understand what I'm saying? And therefore, since it crossed over, I too preach on it. I preach on what is written. And it's very important how you dress. Especially when we understand that our bodies are the temple, what? Of the Holy Ghost. Literally, your body, if you're born again, is the temple of the Holy Ghost. It is the temple of the Holy Ghost. The Spirit of God dwells within you. And just look at it. Just simply look at it. So then, if your bodies belong to God, don't you stand the reason that you should present your bodies in a way in which is acceptable unto God? Yeah. Or in a manner which would show a good image of God? It makes sense. It makes sense. That when you look at someone's manner of dress doesn't tell it all, but at least if you are whatever you're representing, it should be seen in your manner of dress. Many times people are recognized and labeled according to how they dress. Every young man that wears a hoodie and a do-rag ain't a thug. And wears his pants down, which is foolishness, but he's not a thug. But you walk at night at the wrong time of night dressed like that, huh? And they're going to put you on the ground because of what you look like.
That's right.
You understand what I'm saying?
Amen.
A lot of times people say, well, homosexuality, the word homosexual is not in the Bible. Well, the word homosexual is in the Bible. The root word of it is homo. You know, homosexual. You look up in the dictionary homo and it says homosexual. So homo is in the scriptures. When Paul was speaking about how the women and the men have lust after each other, and the scriptures talks about how the angels lust after each other, the men burning their own lust, and they say it like in like manner, men burning and they lust one toward another. That word like manner means homo. You understand?
Amen.
It means homo. Then homosexuals were identified by their dress. Many of you might have seen Roman movies, different series that they have. You saw a lot of, in the Gladiators, a lot of like Spartacus or things like that, but you've seen a lot of homosexual activity in the days of Rome. If you've done Roman history and Greek history, you find out that there was a lot of homosexuality taking place in the Roman and Grecian Empire. Amen. But now, Jesus, it was going on in Jesus' day and time too. He knew it. He said about John, what did you think you come to see? He said, a reed blowing in the wind? An effeminate man? Then he said, they that are dressed in soft clothing, soft raiment, are in king's palaces. But no, you come to see a prophet more than a prophet. They that dress in soft raiment, real soft and pretty clothing, are in king's palaces. That phrase, soft raiment, means a calamite. A calamite is a young man that is used for sexual favors. Jesus said about John, who do you think you come to see? A reed blowing in the wind, a sentiment? No, no, no. Them little boys that's been over and being used, amen, for the privilege of the kings and the politicians, they in the king's palace. I know what they're doing, but this is a man here. This is a real man. He identified them by the clothing. So your attire speaks volumes. And so then why is it that we have our do's and don'ts concerning the things that we have? Well, because God gave us things and he uses these things to try our hearts to see if we love him. Love the giver more than that which he has given. He gave men the garden and all the trees of the garden. He said, you can freely eat, but now this one tree don't eat. What did God do? He gave them the trees of the garden, and then what did he turn around and do? He also used the trees to test their faithfulness. So God tests us with the things that he has given us. Why is that? Because the things he has given us pertain to who? Us. Things we like, things we desire, things we need, things we want, a part of our life. So he tries to keep us in check to make sure that we're not caught up in the gift and forget the giver. He wants to make sure. This is like he said, what? Love not the world, neither that are in the world. I'm going to try your heart by these things. And the Bible says, when Jesus said, I have to die, and Peter said, Lord, you're not going to die. Remember what Jesus said to Peter? He said what? Get behind me, Satan. Now, what was wrong with what Peter said? I just brought this point out for a reason. You may make a good, warm statement with all sentiments behind it, and it can be demonically inspired. Any statement, no matter how sweet, how good it is, if it goes contrary to the prophecy, if it goes contrary to the plan of God, get behind me, Satan. Peter was speaking like a true friend. You're not going to die, Peter. If I don't die, you don't live. If I don't die, the Holy Ghost will not be poured out upon all flesh. If I don't die, all of humanity will be destroyed. Nice gesture, Peter. I understand that you mean well. But when I ask you who the men say that I am, and you said the Son of God, a man, flesh and blood didn't reveal it to you, but my Father in heaven. Now, on this statement, flesh and blood didn't reveal it to you, but the devil, my enemy, did. You want to encourage me not to fulfill my destiny? Get behind me, Satan. And this is what he said, speaking to the spirit that moved upon Peter. Because you savior, you desire the things that be of men and not of God. Now you see why the devil's in our business? He desires the things that be of men and not of God. That's why he's a master of temptation. He desires these things. Now, so, let's look at clothing. And I'm all through here. First, follow me. It's really, you don't need a master's degree. God created Adam and Eve, and you know how the preacher say, talk to me now, let the walls talk. I don't need the wall to talk. I don't need the chairs to walk. But you can respond if you want to. There's a family gathering here. I just want to show you real quick how important every phase of the scripture is and what I teach you when I teach you church standard. I am not teaching personal conviction. God created Adam and Eve how, church? How were they created? Naked. Everybody say it. Naked. That's why the Bible says naked come into this world. Naked to be. They came into the world naked. They had no clothes on. You know the story. But after they sinned, their eyes were open. Then sinful sentiments entered into the world, like lust, murder, lies, envy, and strife, because they were disobedient. This is why the Bible calls children of the world the children of disobedience. And when they sinned, they both realized they were what? Naked. And the Bible says in Genesis 3, and the eyes of them both were opened, and they knew that they were naked. And they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves aprons. Break it down. They made themselves what? Aprons. Listen to the word. Aprons. Skirts. Aprons. But they were what? Topless. So man took the leaves and they made aprons to put around their bottom part. And when they heard the voice of God come, they hid themselves. And you know the story, why you hiding? We were naked, so we hid ourselves. Who told you you were naked? Were you disobedient? Of course they were. So what did God do? 3:21 says, listen carefully. And unto Adam and unto his what? Wife, did the Lord God what? Make coats of skin. And did what? Clothe. What they made was not acceptable. So don't even think that God won't accept everything you put on if it's not up to his standard. Because he's not. He didn't do it in the beginning, and he ain't doing it now. And so, and when you study the word coastal skin, it's a robe-like garment that comes from the shoulder all the way down to the sleeves, and it comes down to cover the legs. Who made these garments? Out of coastal skin. And he covers both what? Man and woman. Now let's look at it. He gave both of them what? Coats of skin. But he made one for the man, and he made one for the woman. So if they had a Sears and Robot of JCPenney's back in that day, when they would go in to look at clothes, they would see nothing but robes. So the clothes would what? Look alike, but they would be what? Different. Robe for the man, robe for the woman. So now, let me ask you something here. So, who created the first acceptable clothing for men? God did. Okay, now, let's look at this. God is a
spirit.
Say it, church.
Spirit.
God is a spirit. Can you use imagination with me? So here is the spirit God, right? And the spirit God is bringing to, well, what kind of spirit is God?
Holy
Spirit. So the spirit of God is coming to Adam and Eve. Here comes some clothes. Can you imagine that? Well, they can't see God. Here comes some clothes here. Put this on. And the spirit of God, which is a what? What kind of spirit?
Holy
Spirit is clothing his son and his wife. What type of clothing do you think this holy God has given him?
Holy
clothes. What else could he give them? Clothing that is what? Acceptable to him. So, because you put on clothes don't mean God accepts it. Because he didn't accept the aprons that they made. But now, why did God clothe them? What was the purpose of that? Just because they were naked? What was the purpose of the clothing?
Cover the shame.
To cover their shame. It was a spiritual principle. Like the blood of Jesus covers our sins. Right from the way. It had a spiritual principle. Now they were ashamed and sinful feeling. God clothed them to cover their shame. And that's why we were clothed today in the public, to cover our shame. It's a spiritual principle, see? So we just don't wear clothes to be wearing. God didn't give them clothing for a fashion statement. Clothing was not given for a fashion statement. Clothing was given to cover, to make amends for the sin and the rebellion, and to cover their shame. And the clothing were loosely fit. Now, if you don't like God's taste, you know, sometimes things, what did they say, out of style, right? But you got some type of clothing that's never out of style, isn't that right?
That's right.
The robe is one of them. How about that? As a matter of fact, at the end of the world, Jesus said, he that overcome, I will clothe you with what? That's what he said. I think heaven still, I think they still playing the robe up there in heaven. Hello, church. I think they still pray. You don't tell God, you out of state, you out of style. He's eternal. He clothed, so then watch this. He put up on them robe-like garments that came all the way down. So then God was clothing them after the pattern of what?
Heaven.
Of heaven. Somebody said, why you say that? Well, I tell you, let your will be done on
earth
as it is.
Yeah.
Okay, if those of you that are scholars, if you study the Bible, God told Moses to build the tabernacle. And he gave Moses a tabernacle plan. And where did the plan come from? What was he making a duplicate of? Anybody know? Of the things that were where? In heaven. God's in heaven. Now, how are they going to have to dress any other kind of way? He said, let me show you how we do it up here. And he clothed me. Now remember, man tried to make his own garment with the aprons, right? Did God accept man's style of dress?
No.
No, he didn't. And some of y'all way of dress, he don't accept now. He's the inventor, the creator of our garments. And he made clothing, the same type of clothing, but different for the man and for the woman. Now you understand in Deuteronomy why it is said, Deuteronomy 22 and 5, let not a man put on garments pertaining to a woman, nor a woman put on garments pertaining to man. It is an abomination to God. And not only was it talking about warlike garment, but it was talking about any apparatus that belongs to a man. A woman has no business wearing, and vice versa. Why is that? Because in the beginning, that's what God did. He gave the woman her robe and the man his robe. And but now we're trying to cross-dress it. They had different cults there. When the men would go into the Venus and the star, the goddess of love, they put on feminine colors. And the women would go and worship the god of war. They would put on masculine armor and things of that sort. But he take it further than that. Listen, you wear that which pertained to you. She wears that which pertained to her. Why is that? Because God made the male and female. The man was created in the image of God. And by no means does God want his image to look like a female. Understand? So now, listen. In the beginning, God gave Adam and Eve what type of clothing? Anybody want to argue with that? Anybody want to say I'm misinterpreting that? Is it plainly in there?
Amen.
Now, does anybody know, outside of the head garment, anybody know what any other type of clothing God gave the woman? Is there another scripture where God gave the woman another type of clothing? Is it in the scriptures where God gave a woman, as far as clothing is concerned, any other type of clothing, physical clothing, outside of the robe-like garment?
No.
Is there anywhere in the scriptures where God gave man another type of clothing other than the robe-like garment?
No.
Exodus chapter 28 and 42. God told them to make breeches for the priests, so that when they go up the altar, you cannot see their nakedness. And the breeches must come from the thigh, from the waist, down to the thigh. That's why I tell you young men, if you're going to wear shorts, let it come down past the knee. And when you sit down, it shouldn't show your thigh. Because God said that from the waist down, you know, and it covers the thigh, that your nakedness is covered. That's what he said. But he didn't give that to the woman. Your breeches is where your trousers come from. He didn't give that to the woman. No way in the scriptures. He gave it to the priests, which were men, but he didn't give it to the woman. So I'll break that down. So whenever you're wearing any type of breeches, trousers, the leg or whatever, you're doing it by permission. And you got to do it right, because you have to understand, God didn't give it to you. Straight up, straight down. As a main garment, he didn't give it to you. As an undergarment, God didn't give it to you, but he did give it to man. You understand what I'm saying? Anybody hear me? Listen. So, now, Isaiah 47, and it says this. Let me hear it. Isaiah 47 says this. Cast down and one, cast down and sit in the dust, O virgin, daughter of Babylon. Sit on the ground. There is no throne. God is rebuking them. O daughter of the Chaldean, for thou shalt be no more called tender and delicate. Take the millstone and grind meal. Now, uncover thy locks, meaning your hair, right? Make bare or make naked your leg. Uncover the thigh. Now, if he's saying make naked, make bare your leg, uncover your thigh. That means your leg and your thigh are what? Women, they come. That's why we tell you to wear your dresses down. Cover your whole leg. One scripture says make bare your ankle. We tell you at least wear your dresses down past your calf, your thigh, your leg, by 2 or 3 inches from your foot. You can't go wrong. That's the type of woman God gave you. You come in here with your legs all out, you're naked. You sit down and your thigh comes all up, you're naked. I didn't say it. And it's not acceptable. In Zephaniah, God told the children of Israel, you come before me with your priests and your incense, and he said, you got on strange clothing. And Zephaniah 1:8. What do you think God meant by strange clothing? Talk to me. Clothing that he didn't recognize. Clothing that did not recognize or represent him. And God called it, you got on strange clothing. In the book of Proverbs, the Bible said, and there he went, and he met a woman dressed in the attire of a harlot. There's a such thing as dressing like a whore. Anybody hearing me? There are certain clothes that are made specifically for a harlot. Like those stilettos, whatever you call them. What's the name of them? Yeah, 4 inches up. 4 inches up, you got on hoe shoes. I didn't say it, Playboy said it. When they brought it out. But you're supposed to be in the temple of God with horseshoes on. Not horseshoes, I'm right. Horseshoes. Let me make that right. Ebony, horseshoes. Y'all understand? You got horseshoes on. I didn't make that up. So now you have to at least admit one thing. When you want to wear your pants and all that out, you have to admit it. According to the scriptures, God didn't give it to you. So now we got to figure out where it comes from. Well, I did a study, and I try to be fair in my studies. And I did a study, and did you know back in the 70s and 60s and in the 70s, it was against the law for women to wear pants? Did y'all know that? It was against the law. And all over the world, women didn't necessarily wear pants as out of garments. It wasn't until World War II here in America, when the women had to go to work in the factory, they wore their husband's clothing. But my God, when the war was over, the women, they didn't want to go home. They didn't want to go home. They didn't want to take off the pants. And Hollywood started coming with the skin tight and the smoking and the roaring 20s. And it's been downhill ever since. But, listen, I did a study on trials and fancies. And in certain parts of the world, they said women wore trousers in certain parts of the world. I did find where in certain parts of the world they were. But as I studied it, for the most part, they were always as undergarments. But there were certain parts where women did wear trousers. So I had to admit that there were some trousers made for women. However, God didn't give it to them. So there's a reason with the scriptures. God gave both of them garments that look alike. So he didn't say that the clothing couldn't be similar. They just couldn't belong to in particular. You understand? Because they both were wearing robes. But the man couldn't wear the woman's garment, neither the woman the man. But their clothes looked alike. So I can find in history where at times, just like men used to wear high heels. And long wigs, but they were not godly. But nevertheless, I did find in history where they say at times women were wearing trousers. But as I studied this study, in the majority of cases, they were undergarments. They came out with the bloomers, and then later on the bloomers came out to the slacks. So now, to be fair, I realized then that women wearing pants is a man-given thing. God didn't give it. However, if they're going to wear something that looks that is similar to a man, they got to make sure that they're not wearing something that belongs to a man. So now you have to make a distinction on men's pants and women's pants. If, and you only wear it by permission, but now to wear it as an outer garment, you are sinning, because that ain't what God gave you. When you read the New Testament, and even all through the Old, when it says dressed in modest apparel, and the women in their apparel, the word actually means dress. Costume, a dress, a garment that hangs down. It actually means dress. Dressed in modest apparel. Costume, an overflowing garment, because that's what God gave. And let this overflowing garment be modest, women. Clothing is not made to show you everything. I know my mama gave it to me, but she didn't give it to you to display to everybody. And you are the temple of God. You have no business dressing, and we can see your every curve and crinkle. And God help you husbands and let your wife do so. You ask him for trouble. Oh, she looks fine to me and everybody else. She looks fine to everybody else too. Because you're displaying your body. Isaiah chapter 3 talks about the women, proud women. Y'all know that. God said, they're haughty, they're proud. Walking around, switching as they walk, as they walk, tingling the ominous on their feet and their hands and the jewelry and all the fancy mirrors and all the God said, I'm going to take it from them. That's what happened with Satan, all the jewels. He got caught up in his own beauty. Somebody said, I can wear this because I do this. I can dress like this. I ain't got to be beautiful, but fine, don't do it. It don't mean nothing, don't do it. That's another story. But we're talking about dressing. So what I teach, and may God have mercy, I teach if you wear any type of pants on women, they have to be pull-ups. All trousers were pull-ups at first, and then they made the button fly. They made the fly for the men. And in the 1900s, they made the zipper. And it said, the French inventor said, that new invention has came out, and they have now got a zipper fly for men. A zipper is an apparatus. But Deuteronomy says, don't wear that which pertaining to a man. That word pertaining to mean any apparatus that belongs to a man. So if you got on any type of pants, women, and you don't want them to be men pants, you ain't got no business with a fly in it. But no zipper. That distinguishes a man's garment. But you know what some of y'all borderline folks started doing? Y'all started taking your pants and turning them around backwards. Same woman. If you got any type of pants on and trousers on at all, and when I mean trousers, if a woman wears trousers or pull-up at all, it should be undergarments, not your main dress. If you walk out the house with your pants on, you're naked. You're an abomination before God because he didn't give it to you. It's not written. He didn't give it to you. And he has a reason for it. He showed us how to cover ourselves. And it's an act of rebellion. You don't need to be looking like a man. He gave men breeches, but he didn't give it to y'all. Anybody know what I'm saying? But if by chance you make a pair of breeches, women, like a woman, use it as an undergarment that belongs to women. Your husband ain't got no business wearing it, but you got some guy wearing these tight jeans and leggings. Are you serious? They say blue jeans was the first unisex garment for men and women. Well, honey, if that blue jean ain't pulled up without a fly, don't put it on. And you get out there in the public, and if it is pulled up the neck, you better have it covered with your proper attire. God gave you robe-like garment. Woman, he gave you a dress. And the scripture says it. Dressed in modest apparel. The word means dress. That's what he gave you to make a distinction. Now, you got a lot of holy preachers would tell you, don't even wear your leggings. Don't wear no stockings. But I didn't tell you that. I did find in history where they weren't pants that were made for women. I did find it. However, it's a man-made garment. God didn't give it to you. You better read the book. He didn't give it to you. So when you get out there and you walk around in your pants, you have disregarded the clothing that God did give you. And you walk in rebellion. And yes, I'm covered, but you're naked. You're naked in the spirit. You're naked in the spirit realm. You see, you're naked before God because you're walking in rebellion. He didn't give it to you. Why? Because he not only does he clothe you for a difference to make cover your nakedness, but he made a difference in the male and female. Anybody hearing me? All you men that's so caught up in your hat, want to put an extra curl in your hat. Apparently, listen. Let me tell you something. You know who has hair like a woman and a face like a man? Bible says a demon does. That's why Ron got killed. He was so caught up in his hat, weighing his hat. Pretty boy, and his hair got caught up in a tree and cost him his life. His pride brought him down. That's another story. But when we teach you women to wear your dresses and you cover your legs and your thigh, Bible teaches that. God gave it to you, and can't no man take it from you. He didn't give you no other type of garment to wear out front. He didn't give you all breeches. He didn't give you all trousers. He gave it to men. But if by chance you wear them, you got to wear pants that are fit for a woman. He didn't say the clothing couldn't look alike. So men began to make trousers for women to wear. Where does the sin come in at? If they're exactly like the man, same way, you see, and if they wear them as a main garment, you sin it because God didn't give it to you. You're naked. Because he didn't give it to you. Read the book. He didn't give it to you. He gave woman the gold black garments, and he didn't give her breeches. And somebody say, well, then why are you going to wear it? Well, you wear it like an undergarment. He didn't give you underwear. He didn't give you a bra.
Amen.
But you wear it. Now let your husband come wearing a bra. Well, being serious about it. Let your husband wear a bra and be serious about it. I ain't saying doesn't put on a bra. I'm talking about being serious about it. All right? Either has an ear or understand. Yeah. Now, what I'm saying. But as long as your undergarments are made for you. Amen. They have to particularly belong to you. First they praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
I'm just through. And we can go into the scriptures. The scriptures say, dress according to women professing godliness, not with gold and pearls and all this doggone jewelry on and all this costly array and all this, but which women profess godliness. Women that profess godliness don't dress like. But we'll get into that, the reason why. The wearing the adorning of jewelry is idolatry. Y'all serious? You need to know what you're doing. But let me ask you something. Listen to what I'm saying. We saw that God gave Adam and Eve clothes that looked alike, right? And what was the purpose of the clothing?
Combination.
And so that's a spiritual principle behind it, isn't it? Now, man tried to cover himself with apron, but did God accept his style of dress? No, sir. When the children of Israel were dressed with strange clothing and foreign clothing, God called it what? Strange clothing. In Deuteronomy, God said that a woman should not wear that which what? Nor should a man wear that which what? In Exodus, we found that God gave the priests what?
Riches.
Travel. Did he give it to the women?
No
way in the scriptures. So when you wear it, know that you're wearing a man-made garment. And it looks like man's garment. If you're going to wear something that's similar to man, make sure that it belongs only to you. And you wear them as undergarments. You don't come in with a miniskirt on and all your pants laid showing. Huh? It should barely even be noticed that you got them on. Because God didn't give it to you. Somebody said, you're going to take it back? I ain't taking it back. I tell you what. Keep on putting your pants on this and wearing ungodly stuff and what happened. And if you do wear them with undergarment, you know you got on man's breeches, you still sin. You keep on going. And when he say, I'm gonna put a white robe on you, when he get ready to come and undress you and put the robe on, he gonna stop. What? they're going to be in style throughout eternity. God got good taste. Yeah. So when you're wearing, as a matter of fact, look at your dresses. Women dressing all over the world, except for them to dress, always come down. All over the world. Why? From the robe. You see? Men, the men's robes were not quite as long as women, but the suits were like the outer garments. They had the inner garments and the outer garments. That's what suits are like, miniature robes. With the outer garments, the suit, you know, most of the time they come down by the cover of the waist. You see? And then there are the trousers that God gave the priest. Anybody hear me? Know that this is scripture. This is scripture. This is scripture. Dressed in modest apparel. The word apparel. You don't have to listen. Some of y'all don't really think y'all smart anyway. Go look it up. Do your own research. I'm going to find out what you need, what I'm talking about. And then you're going to have to hit the Asian side of me. I'm going to find out what you're Asian talking about. Then you got to hit the Irish side of me. I'm going to find out what the Irish is talking about. You look it up, and I'm going to find out what the African talking about. Find out. Because I'm sure what I'm saying. You understand what I'm saying? And you can read it. You see what I'm saying? Well, I'm closing. Let's get ready for the office. So I'm going home. You know what? I didn't really see it. Shut up. You got to shut up. I didn't really see it. You didn't see that he gave both of them robes? You didn't see that he gave the priest breeches and trousers and then give it to the women? You didn't see Deuteronomy say that the clothes be different? Dressed in modest apparel, the word means dresses. Look it up. You want to go to your old strong and say custom. Look up custom. It means the attire of a woman, a dress. You go to the newer ones, it tells you dress. Anybody hear me? Modest apparel dress. Modest apparel. Skin tight. Butt showing. Dress talking. Dresses ain't modest. You're the temple of God. Amen. Represent him. So you see then that God does speak on clothing. Because it has a purpose for it. He gave clothing to us. And we're going to tell him what we're not going to do. He gave it to us. Did y'all read that in Genesis? He gave it to us. We have some good seamstresses here. Men and women, they can sew. Y'all can throw down, throw back. God is the master. What's the word for a man? Seamster?
Taylor.
He's the master tailor. He laid the foundation. You understand what I'm saying? So next time y'all walk out the house with the pants on, just know you better not die that way. Why? Not because of the pants, but because of your spirit. You're rebellious. He's using pants just to show you up. They're rebellious. I'm just running to the store. Yeah, you better hope you don't get in an accident before you get back to the door. Anybody hear me? I'm not making this up. Modest apparel means modest dress. God gave you women dresses. Robe like woman, and gave the man the same. That's why when a man wears a robe like garment, you don't call him out of his name. But God gave it. Hello. And he gave it to the woman too. He's still wearing it. How many years ago was that? 6,000 years ago? And they still in style. People are still dressing this way. Are you serious? And when I was at the airport in Nigeria, they said, man, I don't know about America. They said, we have our traditions, isn't that? And customers said, but America ain't got no kind of traditions. They don't have no customs. They dress to do anything, any kind of way. Well, here's their praise the Lord. So you understand that, right? You're all the temple of God. You see what I'm saying? And listen, and before you get married from now on, they don't want the blood test, but get the blood test. In the future, look for birth certificates. Make sure they are who they are. Amen. men or women. I'm serious. And hey, they got Facebook and they got media, ask for it. Give me your address right now. Give me a minute, leave them alone. Because they're going to clean it up if they save it. Especially if they save it. Because you want to see if they save it. Amen. For real. And y'all know y'all media will show that. Y'all are crazy. God be so crazy, they put everything on their Facebook. Everything. But that's why you look for it. Get it? See if they say it or not. Man. Baby, what you think? Man. I'll see you later. Baby, what you think, honey? I got enough problem trying to stay right. I can't keep up with you. Hello? The world uses them. You use it too to tell on a person, don't you? Church say, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
You're going to display yourself. Do it as a Christian. Representing God. You are the temple of the Holy Ghost. You hear me? And the scriptures does teach a woman to look like a woman. Dress like a man, vice versa. And that modest apparel, it literally means dress. God gave us the garments, and he didn't give a woman, he didn't give, and I'm telling you from the depth of my heart, he didn't give you another garment as such. If you wear anything, it does not substitute or take the place of what God gave you, the type of garment that he gave you. You understand? You show me a woman that can't stay out of her pants, and I show you a rebellious woman. Hard to humble herself. She's proud and rebellious. If she do it before God, what you think she'll do with you? Hello? Everybody's so quiet. I ain't taking it back. Y'all need to just repent, that's all. Repent. And know that I'm not teaching no man-made doctrine. There's a difference in male and female. Anybody hear me?
Amen.
That's a difference. If you wear anything other than what God gave, you're doing it by permission. That means if you're wearing man-made garments, but do it right. Woman, wear that which pertains to you only. And if you're going to wear any type of leggings or anything, will happen, they're undergarments, not the main dress. God didn't give you that. It does not take the place of what he gave you. He gave you robe-like garments to wear, and he ain't changed it. He gave you dress-like garments to wear, and he has not changed it. All over the world, you go to the bathroom. How do you tell the men's bathrooms from the women's? Y'all see the pictures? All over the world. So it ain't no new thing. Now, it may be new as to what come out of it. But it ain't no new thing. God bless you. Give the Lord a hand for the offering. If you want to. Everybody go on, y'all go to the ground. You know, I always say, well, this stuff is different. Because this is right. It was simple. God, we thank you. We appreciate you. Help us to understand that the things you give to us have principles behind them. It's not just the garment that you're looking at, but it's the condition of the heart. And you may use the garment to try our hearts and our spirit. But help us to follow the example you have set. After all, you are the creator of the male and the female. And you know how we should look. We appreciate you. And we thank you for covering our shame, because you could have took their lives. But instead, you covered their shame. And we want to thank you for covering ours. In Jesus' name, the church, amen.